Thank you, General Malik. Thank you, Ambassador Chennai, for having me here this afternoon. My apologies for speaking something beyond what General Malik described. I'll be talking about the air war in Kargil. About the contemporary part, I'll take up probably in the question and answer session. Right, as General Malik described, were we surprised? Definitely so. The Air Force and the armies generally prepare for the war which they fought previously. And therefore, we were all ready for a conventional war. We had trained for that. Our equipment, our logistics, our chain, our type of aircraft which we had selected, all were very conducive for fighting the 1971 war probably once again. But that was not to happen, and we found ourselves in a new situation. And I think the bottom line was that we rose up to the challenge and achieved what exactly we set out to do. That is to employ air power with a lot of precision and accuracy. I'm sure all of you are aware of the geography and the shape of Jammu Kashmir, especially since yesterday after Article 370 was repealed. Let me just leave it at that and take you to the next slide and show where exactly we fought the air battle. I mean, we had these various subsectors. Let me get into some more details. We had some subsectors. If you were to start from the west to east, we had the Mushko Valley subsector, then the Dras subsector, followed by the Kaksar subsector, and finally the Batalik subsector to the extreme east. If one were to now sort of make it simple and get out of the terrain and look at it very simplistically, this is how it looked to the Air Force eye. You have the Kargil located somewhere right here in the center, and then the various other points which I think so most of you are familiar with. This is how the terrain looks to the person from the top. This is a view looking just west of Tiger Hill, down, that is towards the north, towards the town of Gultari. If Kargil was on our side, Gultari was on the other side. It is about 13 kilometers from the line of control, and the line of control is what extends here. What is directly visible is the fact that our side is higher, and then it gradually slopes down to their side of the border. It's extremely difficult to patrol here, and all helicopter flights or whatever to make sure that the LOC was sacrosanct and nothing was happening in these areas, you can see the level of difficulty. Simply put, if I were to put that again in a sort of a simplified graphic layout, this is how it looks. The Indian side had a steep slope upward, followed by a gradual slope downward to the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir side, and the LOC ran somewhat like a straight line like so. Simply put. And if one were to look at it as a section view, that's how it was. India with a steep slope rising upward from its valley, down, so a gradual slope down to the LOC. And if one were to put them all together, amalgamate the whole lot, this is how it looked. Our challenge was that air attacks were not possible in these areas unless you cross this red line. I mean, there's a sort of a red line, and all this talk about, you know, not crossing the LOC was all there with the mandarins of South Block and the people at air headquarters. We were committed to drop bombs, and if we had to do that, we had to do this. So crossing the LOC was not an option. It was a mandated necessity. We tried our level best to stay one side of the line of control. That was our directions given to us by the leadership. However, that was not possible if we wanted to do our job. And if the job had to be done, we had to cross this line. The targets were located, as I showed in this particular thing, in the extreme corners, in the bottom of the valley. Obviously, they would do that to keep themselves safe from our artillery shelling. And therefore, if you had to get at them, you had to come from the north. And if you had to come from the north, you had to cross over. While it was very good to say that we were not doing this, but the fact is we were. We were doing it on a daily basis. And if you would like to read about it, please look up Mr. Kaiser Toffel, an Air Commodore Kaiser Toffel, who's written very accurately of what transpired from the Pakistan Air Force point of view on our air campaign. I think he's perhaps been fairly accurate and probably has probably covered more than what any one of us have done in the public space. Air Commodore Kaiser Toffel on the air war in Kargil. some of the equipment which we did not have in the Mirage and which we had to conduct trials for. Remember, this is just a 50-day war. And within the 50-day war period, we had to do some trials which were normally taken the Air Force over 3 to 4 years to complete. But these were done in quick succession and in rapid pace, primarily because we had a number of test pilots available in the Mirage fleet at that time, of which I happened to be one. And it was war and we had to do it. I just barely touch upon what the capability of the Air Force is, but what I would like you to look at is within the valley, operating out of Srinagar and Avantipur, we had about 45 aircrafts. All of them are listed here. And outside the valley, we had deployed another 45 aircraft. That's all that took part. It is possible for the Indian Air Force to put at least 4 times this number into that same space if we wanted to. That is the flexibility of air power. Within the bases available to us, it was possible for us to put in at least 4 times this number of aircrafts within a 24-hour period over Kargil. That we elected to put only 90 with a choice we made. Look at the deployment, Mirage 2007 7 Squadron, 10 aircrafts at Adampur, Jaguar 13 aircrafts, all located again at Adampur, and the same with a MiG-25, one single MiG-25 operating out of Adampur. And in Ambala, we had again one squadron of Mirage 2000s, 14 squadron Jaguar 10 aircrafts, as well as Canberra 1 aircraft at Ambala. So just total 90, 45 in the valley and 45 outside the valley. There were many more aircrafts available, but they were not being tasked. This is a summary. You will see the total sorties is about 1663 for day operations alone. And if you went back to look at night operations, another 87 more were flown. And this is on that 50-day period. And the total flying, if one were to add up, was 1,750 sorties over a 50-day period. Let me put it in perspective by telling you that during Operation Gagan Shakti, we flew something like almost 5,250 missions in a 5-day period. That's what we achieved. That is the sort of concentration we can bring into the battlefield. And remember, at that point in time, in 1999, the Indian Air Force had 42 fighter squadrons. When Gagan Shakti took place, we had only 32 fighter squadrons with us. So that is the sort of powers we can get into the battlefield if we wanted to. If we wanted to, we could have at least duplicated Gagan Shakti at that time. This is the fleet-wise armament summary. Just to put it in a nutshell, we dropped about 923 bombs, tonnage 313 tons. This is outside the valley. We dropped another bombs, about 234 bombs and 91 tons. Of these, only 8 LGBs were dropped by the Mirage and 1 LGB by the Jaguar. Some of the milestones, at least from the air perspective, are as follows. On the 21st of May, Canberra carrying out a recce of the area which we knew to be probably having intruders in it, was hit by a Stinger somewhere in the Bedalik sector. The aircraft landed back safely in Srinagar, but was there on the ground for almost 6 months before it could fly again. On the 26th of May, the air campaign officially started. The CCS, I believe, gave approval on the 25th of May evening, and on the 26th, we started the air campaign with disastrous effect. On the 27th, we lost one MiG-27, which had crashed due to the aircraft trying to fire its gun at high altitude, which is not cleared by the pilot's notes. It not authorized by the manufacturer. The gun gas injection which took place into the engine caused it to flame out, and the pilot, Flight Lieutenant Nachiketa, ejected. Condit Ajay Ahuja in a MiG-21 tried to spot him and tried to sort of fix his location. Probably went a bit too low and got shot down with a Stinger. Nachiketa, as you are aware, was a POW at that stage, and Ahuja had probably died. On the 28th of May, one Mi-17 was shot down with 4 of our air warriors on board. And this is an attack on 5140 point near the Toloring area. On the 7th of June, from the Mirage perspective, we started the air attack for the first time at 0.5140. On the 16th of June, we picked up Munthudalo and struck it. I will have a video which will show you exactly what I am talking about a bit later. On the 24th of June, we struck Tiger Hill. On the 6th of July, we commenced attack on point 4388. 4388 is a point which ran from Gultari towards Tiger Hill. It was one of the valleys which I had shown you in the earlier graphics, and we pumped in a lot of heavy weapons into this particular area. 4388 is one of the least talked about air campaigns, but I think we put in a lot of weapons into this place. And by the 12th of July, the end of the air campaign drew near because we didn't have any more targets to hit. I'll talk a bit about this end a bit later, but suffice it to say that the Mirage fleet at that point in time, I was a member of that fleet, we did not have any suitable air-to-ground weapons, primarily because the aircraft were procured for air defense, and that was the glamour task in the Indian Air Force. Dropping bombs is something which Agarwal, Packers and Movers can also do. What we were doing was air defense, and air defense was where we did air combat, where we were like swashbuckling cowboys, floating about with the BVRs and within visual range missiles. I think that was where the all the glamour and glory was. Air ground weapons had not been procured. Fortunately for us, the Ajit aircraft had, which had been manufactured by HAL, had been decommissioned, and along with it, a number of Spanish weapons which had been procured for the Ajit aircraft became surplus and were available to us to use. We had a limited number of trained pilots, obviously because most of us had not been exposed to air-to-ground weapons at all. Fortunately, in the Converse, we had three test pilots who were available. The training status of the ground crew, obviously, if you do not drop bombs, you're not aware of how to load them, how to fuse them, and how to set them for flying. And the lack of roll equipment, you know, in addition to the bombs, you have to have the trolleys, the hydraulic apparatus required to load these things up. They are about 1000 kg weight or more at times, and they have to be lifted up into slot and locked into the cocking mechanism before they can be dropped. And obviously, not being tasked, we didn't have tools and testers. All these were various challenges which we faced. Some of the achievements before I get on to the video is what first we established was a no-fly zone in that area. That entire area extended at least 10 to 20 kilometers into Pakistan, and we enforced this by flying a number of air defense missions. 0.5140, where we already told you where we dropped a number of bombs, not too much though. Munthodalo, I think, was the turning point in the air battle. I will get into more details, and I think this probably is the single largest attempt by our armed forces to get at Pakistan, where we achieved massive success. In the sense, I do believe over 300 plus Pakistanis were killed in just under 6 minutes under air attack. I don't think it's ever happened before in our history of our armed forces, in India at least. Tiger Hill, talk about, and then finally conclude with 4388. This is how we used to operate. We were, the aircraft used to get airborne from Ambala. These were the escorts. They used to be armed with the Super 530Ds. We had an asymmetric advantage over Pakistan in the sense we had BVRs, they did not. And therefore, there was this strength which we had, which we do not have today in terms of a technical asymmetry. The first sets of Mirage used to get airborne from Ambala. The total distance from Ambala to Kargil was of the order of about 600 kilometers one way. The second set of Mirages, that was the strike formation, used to get airborne from Adampur, which is just next to Jalandhar. We used to RV somewhere around Dalhousie. No RT calls, obviously, because we do not want to alert the enemy. And we used to change this RV point regularly so that we kept outside the radar cover of Pakistan. Once we did that, we used to set course as a composite formation towards Kargil. And this took us about half an hour to get to Kargil. The endurance of the aircraft permitted me to operate with impunity at that height in the Mirage 2000 for approximately about an hour and 45 minutes over Kargil, and then set course back to base. And we used to land back at Adampur and to Ambala, as the case may be. This is the same thing which we did both by day as well as by night. The forces which were within the valley used to get airborne from Srinagar and from Avantipura, a distance of less than about 100 kilometers. And this is how the war was fought. We used to have forces airborne from Srinagar as well to give us air defense cover if the need required. Now, before I get on to Munthodalo, which was the first success which we actually achieved, I'll try to explain what exactly is the technical details of how we put in an attack from high altitude. The first challenge raised in picking up the target, and that was required by a distance of at least 15 kilometers from the targets, which meant that you had to pick up the target by 15 kilometers and designate it to the system. The system had to be told, this is the target, fix it. And from then onward, the system gave you guidance to drop the bombs accurately. And the level of accuracy depended upon system performance. And in the case of the Mirage, the system was so good that with dumb bombs, we could get accuracy of under 20 meters. Remember, these bombs were of the size of 500 kgs or more. And therefore, an accuracy of 20 meters was spectacular, actually. And it was important that we had to designate the target and level out by a height of 10,000 feet. The reason being that below 10,000 feet, there's a chance of a Stinger missile being fired at you. And thereafter, you sort of leveled out after designating the target. From then onwards, you are not seeing the target. All you are doing was following the command guidances from the aircraft system to get you to a path which would make sure that you sort of reached a place from where the bombs would get delivered automatically. You authorize the delivery, the aircraft dropped the bombs. That's the way it worked. Let me remind you again, we're talking about Munthodalo next. This is the 16th of June, and Munthodalo is in the right of your chart, boxed in red. This is Munthodalo, as you will see in the film as it runs. I want you to look for this particular tent, where you will find one person come out, show his face probably and move around. Now, what exactly you are seeing here? What you have here is about 70 Pakistani tents in the wilderness, roughly at a height of about 14,000 feet. It is still snowbound. This is the 16th of June. And these tracks which you see running along the snow, running towards the south side of this image, are probably them, you know, trudging on a daily basis to the lavatories to relieve themselves. When the video runs, I'll show you where this happens. What you have here is the 16th of June. We have yet to pick up Munthodalo. The search for Munthodalo. We are aware it exists somewhere, but you are not very sure where it is. And what you see here is the pilot panning the Litning laser designation pod and looking for the target in relation to bombs which have been dropped earlier. You can see these craters on the snow. They are actually where the bombs had impacted in the past, where we were dropping these on a GPS target on coordinates. And in relation to these, I want you to notice this particular mushroom shaped thing with a crater in the center, because it has got some relevance. And you will see for yourself how Munthodalo was first picked up. This is the 16th of June at 7:46 in the morning. The pilot immediately zooms out so that he has a lay of the land available to him for targeting it when he comes to next. Now, the same image is now playing with the target now being struck. This is actually filmed on the 17th, but we struck it the same afternoon at 12 o'clock. And what you can see here is all those 70 tents have been destroyed. We dropped 6 tons of bombs. We dropped 24 250 kg bombs from 4 Mirage 2000s and devastated the entire area. What you will notice are these, you can see all the tents, the Arctic tents have been destroyed, as well as you can still see the tracks in the snow, which what is left of it. This is the 17th, a bomb damage assessment carried out 24 hours after the event. The date and time is visible at the bottom. You can see it is written 17th of June and the time is 7:46. I'll now briefly talk about Tiger Hill, and before that I will try to explain in some technical details of what the Litning pod was all about. The Litning was a day-night pod. We had only a day pod on the Mirage at that time. We had contracted for this pod in 1997. Unfortunately, delivery had not yet taken place and there were integration issues going on. The pod was supposed to have been integrated as per the contract by the year 2001 or so. However, because Kargil happened and we had no choice and we wanted to attack by day and night, the Litning pod was inducted in a bit of a hurry. Fortunately for us, as I explained before, we had the resources to do this task. We had help from the Israeli friends who flew into Gwalior, and we got the ball rolling. The laser designation pod, simply put, consists generally of two types of cameras. We have a CCD camera and an IR camera, along with a laser gun, which are so located so that they fire along the same line. So therefore, if one were to look at a target, it was possible to fire the laser through the same direction as well, in the same crosshair. And there was this mirror assembly which allowed the ball swivel of the lightning pod to look all around itself except for into itself. But everywhere else it could sort of swivel around and see. The turret itself rotated 360 degrees, while the ball itself rotated about 10 degrees above and minus 150 degrees below. And this is the sort of area which you could not see. The sector within the red arc was not possible to be seen. However, the sector outside it, the whole 150 degrees plus minus, were visible. This is how a laser guided bomb looks at, and some of its features. And what happens in a laser guided bomb attack, if you want to look it from the top, is as follows. The aircraft comes from the left of your screen, and target has to be acquired by 20 kilometers. This is not as difficult as in the case of Muntudalo, because now you are looking at a very magnified image. At 20 kilometers, you have to acquire the target. By about 15 kilometers, you are supposed to designate it as before, and then you continued accelerating the aircraft and drop the bomb by about 8 kilometers from the target. And thereafter, you threw in a turn to the left or right, as the case may be, and illumination of the target continued till you came to as close as 5 kilometers. And the bomb actually hit the target when you are about 6 kilometers away. Again, Tiger Hill, the next. It's just north west of Dras, boxed in red, and this is how it looks, Tiger Hill. And what the video film will talk about is this particular area alone, because remember, we are looking at it from 30,000 feet up and down. Here is Tiger Hill once again, and this red circled area is where 9 enemy tents were perched, right at the very tip, overlooking National Highway 1A. You will notice the date. There's the 24th of June. It's in the right center, and also the time. It's 7:11 in the morning, and the aircraft is rushing towards Tiger Hill at a speed of about 1,000 kilometers per hour. The range to target at the moment is there. It is written as 25.5 kilometers in the right top, bottom of the screen. While this takes a long time when you're actually playing it out, the fact is, in the air, it really goes past very fast. You're more worried about getting everything right. We were doing it for the first time, and there were a lot of gray areas. We were worried, especially about the winds, because when the winds at that point in time, when flowing from west to east, which was the general direction in most of the year around, was of the order of 70 knots, and our bomb was only cleared for 50 knots crosswinds. And therefore, there was this challenge that we had to make sure that we hit it despite being outside its weapon tolerance. We actually went down in height. We were earlier planning the attack from 26,000 feet. We went down to 24. We reduced the crosswind component to 60 knots or so, but we carried on. Now, you'll see this 9 tents which are perched on the very tip. And if one looks very closely, you will even find 3 people running when the bomb is arriving. The bomb has been dropped, and the aircraft is in a sharp turn to the left with 4G, and there's one person running across. Look at this white portion, you will find a shadow go across him. Can you see it? There's one more, we'll cross now, and the bomb is on its way. Now we are now at 5 kilometers from the target, and very shortly, in 1 second, that was a boom, and we got Tiger Hill. We later came to know from enemy intercepts that 37 Pakistanis died in this one single attack alone. I do have some other videos for you, but let me show you something else. When we were doing all this, this is what the Pakistanis were doing at us. This is just a cross section of the video. If you look somewhere along this axis, you'll find a Stinger come up for us. Did you see that? That was a Stinger which had been fired at us. Some of the other videos which I would like to... talk about was 4388. Now 4388 was some place where, as I explained before, targets were, they were probably in bivouacs there and it was extremely difficult to spot. This is 4388. We used to strip bomb it. One bomb set had gone, another bomb set was put. 6,000 pounders, that is roughly equivalent to 6 times the amount which you dropped at Tiger Hill in one single strip, being dropped systematically. These were dumb bombs being dropped on area bombing. Here is another one of our artillery which we discovered at Batalik, which was actually across the line of control. We unknowingly had crossed over. We located it, and what I want you to notice are these black plumes here. You see these things? They are actually artillery guns which have been firing into the snow, and they have resulted in soot marks for, sort of settling on the snow. Fortunately for us, nobody knew about it. We reported this back that we had crossed unintentionally, and it was sort of hushed up at that point in time. We had gone in almost 20 kilometers in at this point in our eagerness to pick it up. Here is another one of an attack on Tiger Hill. Let me finish now by putting this. I know this is a August gathering of people from all the services and even diplomats. This is what Winston Churchill had to say in 1949. Seventy years after he said this, all I would like to add is aerospace power. Thank you, gentlemen.